Who is Mayor Rudy Claire? That's pretty good. I was, anyway, an elected official. I was elected official for almost 40 years around Gary, Indiana, and Lake County, Indiana. We started out as a state senator. In fact, we were the first African-American state senator from Northwest Indiana serving the Senate. I was the only African-American there at the time. And then we left the state Senate, and we were elected to the Lake County Council. In other words, we came a little closer to home. And then I was elected county recorder in Lake County, Indiana. And then, of course, I was elected to the Board of County Commissioners, and I served in Board of County Commissioners almost 20 years. And then, of course, the clarion call was to become mayor of my hometown, which is Gary, Indiana. And a pretty stressful job, I might add, but, you know, you can't lead people that you do not love, and I love Gary. I love Gary people. We had the best people, you know, and I've said that over and over, you know, everywhere I go. And I don't even get an argument. People don't even argue at that point that we don't have the best people, because we do. And so, and I wanted to be the mayor of the city, and it happened, you know, and I was happy about that. But at the time, Gary was officially designated as the only city in the entire state that was distressed. In other words, the finances were not there. The money was not there. And you were, like my Aunt Daisy used to say, you were taking it from Peter, giving it to Paul. We had to go down state to what is called a distress unit appeals board to try and get them to help us out as it relates to the just a little bit of tax increase so that we can keep the city operating. I mean, you know, you have to pay your police, you have to pay your firefighters, and have to pay your, you know, other first responders, you have to pay your employees, you had to have the garbage picked up. And I was getting somewhere in the neighborhood of probably 40 calls a day on my cell phone for different things that people needed help with, you know. And but you don't realize how stressful it is until you step away from it. And once you step away from it, then your blood pressure go down and you feel much better about it. I said, well, maybe God did the right thing. Well, usually every year I go over to get a physical. I get my flu shots, get my physical, and they take the so-called blood draw and all of this here. And then I got a call from the doctor saying that he wanted to check it a little further with biopsies and all that kind of thing. And after they checked it all out, and it was early, I might add, he said to me, he said, look like you had a prostate cancer, you know. I said, well, let's fix it up, you know, because I got to go back to work. And he said, well, we'll start work on it so that you'll be okay. And of course they did, and you go into process, but you keep praying and everything's gonna be fine, you know, because you don't really know. You know, anytime a person has cancer, I don't care what kind of cancer it is, you know, you don't feel good about it. And of course the prostate cancer is something that, I can't understand ever have that seemingly African-American males get it. I know some friends of mine, you know, has prostate cancer. And I mean friends that were taking exercise in the gym and eating the right things and doing the right things, and they caught the prostate cancer. And I said, I can't even believe that, you know. But it happens to anybody as it relates to African-American males and males. So there is no formula for who, except the women don't, you know, of course, catch it. But there's no really, should I say, pattern to say, well, you're going to catch prostate cancer and you are not. I haven't seen that. That's when I say to all the brothers, I don't care what station in life you are in. I don't care what job you're doing. I don't care how your education is. I don't care what kind of family you came from. I don't care. All I'm saying to you is have your PSA checked. And that will save your life, possibly. And it's not a hard thing to do. And what will happen is you go in, you see the doctor. And when you leave, the doctor will say to you, well, you don't have it. And you're going about your business, you know. So there's no cookie cutter for it, really, that I know of anyway. Like one guy told me he eat a lot of organic food. I say, that's good. Keep eating organic food. That's what you want to do. It's no problem because it helps you, you know, eating organic food. I said, but I'm saying to you right now, you need to get tested to see if any, well, I'm eating organic food, I'm taking exercise and all this and that, you know. And so I don't know. I think he might have got tested though, because I think I convinced him. Well, the blood test was first, you know, but they were not looking for, you know, prostate cancer with the blood test, but that's where they found it. And then after they found it, quite naturally, then you move on to other things, which we did. I told them, hey, whatever's necessary, because I want to live, I want to be healthy, because I got a job to do here in Gary, Indiana, as mayor of the city, and let's get it done, you know. And nobody really knew I had it until after I made the announcement, because I was going on doing my duties every day, working at City Hall, in different places like that every day, making phone calls to people, and people calling me, and dealing with picking up the garbage, make sure we had the police doing their job, firefighters doing their job, employees doing their job, make sure that the citizens of Gary get the services that they deserve and need and want and was paying for. So there wasn't any, should I say, gap in my job as mayor as related to the prostate. In fact, I told the doctor, I said, well, you know, I've been diagnosed with that, but I've been healed by stripes, and I'm going to continue to do what I've been doing for the last 40 years and just keep on. And then, lo and behold, my wife got sick. You know, she had to go to the hospital, and that kind of woke me up. And so I said to my wife, I said, hey, I'm pulling out of the race, and you and I are going to enjoy our senior years here and go ahead on and do something else. Tell you, how has your faith helped get you through prostate cancer? The Bible says, I think it's in Hebrews, says faith is the substance of things hoped for, evidence of things unseen. And I have the faith to know that the evidence of things unseen, which is the healing, is there for me. You know, and I have all the faith is so strong. And I don't believe that anybody can get healed, you know, unless they believe in God. You've got to have some belief out here. You can't go in there saying, well, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in Allah, I don't believe in this, and don't believe in that, and then think you're gonna get all healed up. No, you've got to have faith, you've got to believe. And so my faith is really, really and truly. Because my wife, my son, you know, who's here visiting me now, we don't miss saying a prayer every day. We do not miss, don't miss. So I just say to anybody that faith is it, faith. But now you also got to have faith, got to have hope, and you got to have some love in your heart too. And so if you have those three, you'll be okay. Oh yeah, well my son, he was in Atlanta, Georgia at the time. And he didn't really know until really I decided to pull out of medicine. I called him in Atlanta and told him what was going on. And within 1 hour's time, he was in his car and drove all the way to Gary, Indiana. And boy, that really, I'll never forget that. Well, tears came in my heart, eyes too, you know. See my son give me that kind of love. That made me feel pretty good. It makes me feel good today, in fact. My wife, she's just been a gem, you know. Just a gem, you know. She won't even allow me to go to Chicago to the doctor unless she's there with me, you know. And so the family has been real, really close. And that helps, you know, that really helps. It helped me anyway. It really helped me because that family support, you gotta have a good, strong family. My wife and my son have been there for me every step of the way. Every step of the way. Be a celebrity and catch it. You know, you can be a Farrakhan, minister in the Nation of Islam. You can be Colin Powell, one of the greatest generals of our time, and catch it. You know, and on and on and on. African American males and other males, they must really go and have what is called a PSA, check the numbers out and see what's going on with that. And if you catch it early, you have a better opportunity to save your life. Don't you want to save your life? Of course. Thank you. have anything to do with the Barack Obama campaign. In 2008, I was the Lake County Democratic Chairman, which means we was the chairman of the Democratic Party in Lake County. And Democrat had not won the state of Indiana from the presidency since John F. Kennedy. And so we put a lot of effort in the state. So I got a call from a guy named Dan Parker, who was the state Democratic chairman, and this is around 9 o'clock that night. He says, Barack Obama is losing the state of Indiana right now by 50,000 votes, but Gary, Indiana hasn't come in yet. I said, well, Lake County, all the votes in Lake County wasn't counted that time either. So when they counted them up, Lake County, Indiana, we garnered 139,000 votes for Barack Obama, and we turned a red state, which is Indiana, blue for the first time since John F. Kennedy. And I was on, we were door to door and all on the radio and knocking on doors, and we did that for months, you know, because we wanted him to win Indiana, and he did win Indiana. Of course, he went on, you know, to win the electoral votes and won the presidency, and I was happy about that. Memorable times of being a mayor of Gary, Indiana. I tell you, one time we were, you know, I usually ride with the police sometime to go out and catch the bad guys. And so we had a task force with the sheriffs involved, the state police involved, the IU police involved, which is Indiana University police involved. And we put them all together. And one weekend we went out, and I was riding with the police. And we arrested over 122 people just over the weekend. And riding with the police was quite an experience for me. And I said to myself, I don't know if I should be doing this, because we were stopping people that were just walking down the street looking suspicious. And one guy had an AK-47 on his body, you know. And on, catching a guy with drugs and all kind of things, you know. And so what happened is I got kind of, I kind of liked it because it was taking the bad people off the streets. And I will say that the memory of all of that, working with the police and taking the bad people off the street, you know, and it's not an easy task. I would have to say that was one of the great moments. And the other moment was when we went to Indianapolis, and they were saying to us, "You are a distressed city, but I don't know if we can help you with the money," you know. And so we talked to the governor, Mitch Daniels, who he's going on to be the chancellor at Purdue University now. And so when we started talking to people, I went to Annapolis, lobbying the people that was on the Distress Unit Appeals Board, because if they had not voted for us to get the money, we would have had to close the doors almost. The city hall, we'd have to lay off police and firemen. It would have been a devastating situation. And so we went down there, you know, with the city controller and everybody. And when we walked out of there, we had majority vote, boy, I tell you. And that was a high, because everybody in the city was watching that. And that was a high moment because we keep the doors open. And from then on, we went sailing after that. I mean, it was just a great moment because we were ready to roll.
Were there any memories that you wish that, you know, not so bad memories of Gary?
Well, Gary has great people. Gary has great people. And that's really where you got to put your stake down, right there. The people of Gary, not the bad apples, you know, not the people that's doing bad things, but the great people of Gary. We have in Gary, Indiana, and I don't think people know this, in Gary, Indiana, we have more churches than any city this size in America, in Gary, Indiana. On Sundays, the people in church, and these are church people. These are people who believe, you know, and they're good people. And so Gary has the best people now, I got to say that. Although there are some bad apples, but we need to get those bad apples out here and make Gary a great city and a better quality of life for the people of Gary. That's what we got to do.